So,
How about an old school Kaiser? Yeah, well, what is it when you say old school? So this is a Kaiser Dukes S35BN blade, titanium handle. Yeah, so I already have a Dukes, and man, do I like that knife. It is this little sweetheart of a knife. Oh, careful. Causing chaos here. Yeah. So this is a Kaiser Dukes. G10. What was the steel in this one? VG10 steel. And man, do I like this one. I liked it so much that when I saw the titanium version, I said, man, I gotta get it because this thing is stunning. So is this? I don't know. We're about to find out though. We're gonna go on this journey together. Yeah, this is old school premium Kaiser here. It's got the camo pouch. Look at this thing. It's got a zipper the size of Fort Knox. These are pretty cool pouches. All right. So yeah, you can already see I bought this on the secondary market used, but like new or used new. New in box, never been carried, that kind of thing. And so we're going to take a hard look at all that. All right. Well, first off, I can tell you, I mean, look at the size difference. Wow. I mean, it's interesting because looking at it, the milling pattern matches the milling on this scale, I think exactly. Like when I'm lining up these little mill marks, everything is exactly the same. These two little spots here together, those two, this little point here. I mean, wow. So the same milling, but man, is this knife bigger? Even the flipper tab. I mean, look at this one. This one's got an accentuated flipper tab that's large, but this one has it too. It's just larger. Wow. I mean, man, that is a lot of falada. Wow. Okay. I'm not sure if I'm gonna like that. But here we go. It's a Cucchiara. Cucchiara. Dukes. Made in China. And then here it's got the S35BN on this side. Hollow ground, hollow ground. It's got that same swedge on the top of the blade. I mean, it's a mirror, but it's like they made it 20% bigger. Very solid lockup. I mean, everything I'm seeing, the grind. All looks factory done. It's got a little wear mark on the pocket clip right here. I mean, it's nitpicky, but yeah, I do see some kind of blemish here on the pocket clip. I'm not prepared to say that it's wear from carry, but it's got something going on there. And I know this, if they carried it, they carried it with that sticker on there, because you can't peel that off and put it back on. That don't work. Yeah, some kind of oddity on the pocket clip there. I mean, could have rubbed in a box, who knows? In a box, on a plane, in a train, would you, could you? Interesting. Very interesting. The lock seems a little tight to me, but all that may resolve itself once I'm in the knife. Very hydraulic, very smooth. I mean, that flipper tab, the jimping on this one is not near as aggressive as the jimping on this one. The jimping on this thing, you can see it. Look at how deep and sharp and aggressive this jimping is. I mean, it's wonderful. The jimping here, it's almost completely polished over. So, kind of non-existent. Cucciara. Kaiser Dukes. All right, well, come on, man. Let's get in it. I'm going to move that way over there. It can hang out. I mean, it's a Kaiser Dukes, right? It's the name of the video. Kaiser Dukes. All right, the pivot's in backwards. If I can flip-flop it, I'm definitely going to want to do that. But let's just take it out for now. How about that? Oh, yeah. Yeah. I mean, everything I touch right now is requiring maximum grip with my hand and boiling water. Come on, man. What the? There we go. Yeah, this one's going to need to get boiled too. Come on. I mean, it moved a little bit, but I'll end up stripping that screw off. So, a little hot water, a little dab will do you. I got it to move a little bit, but I'm not going to chance stripping that out. So, off to the water we go. I wonder if I can take the rest of this apart and not get water in these screws and all that kind of stuff. If I can, I'm going to get all that off the knife. Yeah, that come off. I wonder if this one will. Yep. Get this pocket clip hardware off. And maybe the lock insert, the metal insert. Which leaves us with the pivot alone. I don't think there's an over travel stop. Yeah, so now the only thing we have is the pivot. All right, off to the boil. I'll be back. Okay, Boiling, toiling, got it all handled. It did cost us a bit. Yeah, completely wore out my T8 bit. Man alive. Just Loctite it in there just as hard as it could possibly be. But let's go ahead and wipe this thing down and let's put it back together. One of the questions I have is, can I run this pivot from either side? It's captured at the top of this scale. And so the only way is to come in from the other side. Yeah, it got me. And it has to face up, like so. Okay, well, it is what it is. There's nothing I can do about that. But I probably should put this lock insert in first. I'm gonna put a little oil on it and then coat it because this is metal, it's not titanium. I don't want to get it on the face, run the risk of it creating lock stick. And the detent ball is actually in the frame. It's mounted in the frame. You see it? A little ceramic ball in the frame. Interesting, right? Normally, like 100% of the time, I've seen it in the actual metal insert. But on this one, they mounted it in the frame. I mean, I don't know what the significance of that is, but it's cool. It's different, unexpected, and unseen before. I'm not. Like, I get it, these channels review knives and, stick to what they stick to, but has the world lost its freaking mind? What the? This is what I'll say. The lie has become the truth, and the truth has become the lie. It's insane, man, what's going on right now. Really, really puts a whole squash on that, sending my daughter off to an institution of higher learning. Oh, golly, man. When I was boiling here, look at these ceramic bearings here. I mean, man, that's the good stuff right there, right? Legit. I can't even flush it, man. The pandemic hit a couple of years ago, and crazy has come at a breakneck pace, man. Some of it I can't even kind of get my head around it, man. It's just, man. And this stuff right now in the at the colleges. Are you kidding me? I'm gonna put a little bit on that ceramic ball. And then I'm gonna run that over that track a little bit, try to disperse that before it runs off to something else. All right. Man, this thing's gorgeous. I got my My flat spot's out of alignment now. It's way out of alignment. Yeah, this is not the way to do this. Yeah, I mean, the insanity has reached new lows, man. I mean, to the point to where, I mean, I'm sitting here doing this, and while I was boiling, the TV was running in the background. I don't have a background back here where I'm working, a TV, but it was running up front while I was boiling, and watching what's going on, man. It's currently Saturday. What is it? The 4th of May. And so I don't know when this video is going to drop, but I mean, what's going on at the colleges and the news? It's beyond comprehension. Stunning. I gotta move this here because I gotta hold that down for that to stay locked. Ooh. There's a lot of Loctite down in that pivot. I'm gonna have to run it in and then run it out and run it in and run it out. Try to clean some of that out of there. Or I'll be right back where I was. All right. I think I'm... Well, I'm just shy of where I want to be. Yep, there's a tiny little bit of rock in there. There, solid as a rock right there. Ooh, drop shut. Yeah, wow. Yeah, it picked up a little rock there. And back it out. Clear some more of those threads. In there, a little bit of rock and roll, a little bit of country. Yeah, remember that? It's like when I run the action, it frees it up a little bit, and then I can turn it just a little tiny bit more. Man, sakes alive, this action is so good. Yeah, I just got a little more rock. I wonder if it's coming loose or if it's just creating space in there. Wowzy. It's so good. Well, let's get the pocket clip on. Hopefully I don't have to Loctite it. I mean, wouldn't that be insane? Ugh. Come on, man. No Loctite and pocket or pivots. We don't want to add Loctite. I mean, you know, as an old dude, I think back to generationally to coming out of the 50s and the elderly in the 60s, the early 60s, you know, really feeling like, you know, rock and roll and the direction of things and protesting Vietnam and, you know, the perceived unpatriotic nature of that, and you know, all that that was going on, has kind of left me in today's America feeling like, you know, many times have I said, well, I think it's generational because, you know, when I was a kid, you know, it was the end of things then. And, you know, if you listen to the old people, the older generation then, the predominant older generation, which would have been, you know, the generation of the, let's say, 40 and 50 year olds of that time. Not the old, the 60 and 70 year olds, but the 40, 50 year olds of that time period really felt like, you know, the music, the culture, the dress, the hairstyles, everything. It was the end of the civilization, you know, as we knew it. And so I've been cautious looking at some of this sort of in the sense of, well, I mean, I don't want to become my parents. You know, I don't want to sound like they sounded like back in the day, because they sounded ridiculous, you know. But I think that this may be part of it, is that each generation wants to say things like, well, it was never this bad. I never remember it this bad. And I wonder if it's just the level of things that come to each generation feels like it's never been this bad. Like when they said that in the 60s, it's never been like this though. They meant it and it was real. It had never been. It had never been like that. What was going on? You know, Watergate and, you know, Kennedy and Vietnam and, you know, hippies and the protests and free love and rock and roll, man, all of that, you know, that generation of, you know, 40, 50, 55 year olds had never experienced anything like that. They'd come out of the 50s and the sock hop era, you know, through the 40s and 50s and the 60s just seemed like, what? You know, it's never been like this. Well, I think maybe they were right. It had never been like that. I don't think it's ever been like this either. I think it's like that. Each generation has it's never been like this moment. It just gets levels of crazy that you've never seen before. You can't fathom it. Wonder if I need to put a little tension on that, but man, it sure is running good. I think I'm just going to leave it be. And I think it's locking up well. That's maybe probably the test. Yeah, I mean, we're locked up. I'm going to leave it be. It's just so much nicer. So much smoother. I mean, golly, this thing is good. Let's talk about this action. I mean, A minus, hard B plus. It is so smooth and wonderful. I think a couple of things that's going to cause me to take points. This jimping, although it doesn't necessarily need it because of the shape of the flipper, it swoops. And so when you get your finger on it, you're kind of locked in there. Does take, I mean, I'm saying it takes. It is so smooth, man. Golly, this thing is. I mean, it's a A minus to an A for sure. It's not a B anything. It's definitely an A. And of course, the more it gets used, the better it's going to get. Absolutely. Ergonomics are definitely along the lines of a Hinder. These wonderful swoop protected finger guard areas that allow you to really get up in here and grip this knife. And very confident that going forward, if resistance was met, that it would push through and not come up over the blade. So very confident grip, you know, not so confident, confident, very confident. And this thing runs right up to the top of the scale. Very comfortable, can cap this off. It's a little large, but definitely can cap this blade off. Not so much reverse, but... yeah, wow, is this thing, I mean, it's big. This is a large knife coming from like a small to a medium to definitely a large to an extra large. I mean, we skip the medium to the large size. We jump two sizes here. Let's check the pocket clip. Man, this thing is so good. The Dukes. Come on now. Let's get over the thick stuff. There it is. And it ran all the way. So it's not a deep carry clip. It's a milled titanium pocket clip. And it does leave a reveal of over a half an inch of knife. Albeit very attractive reveal. Just a lot going on there. It's a good looking pocket clip. Good looking scalloping on the blade itself. Or on the scales. On standard jean size material. Definitely easier in there, very smooth. I'm not going to call it a dryer clip only because it's so smooth and it's so big, but it's pretty secure. I mean, it should hold there just fine. Wonderful ramping on both sides. Yeah, pretty cool. I like it. Let's check it for safety. Any blade contact? Who is that cavernous? Man, that is wide. That is a Grand Canyon between those scales right there. But it's designed, the blade is tucked down in there, no chance of contacting it, and the tip is very protected. So the clip is good, the tip is good, and no chance of incidental blade contact. I wonder if this hollow ground is sharp as it looks. I mean, I'm going to start with a strop. Let's get one on it. All right, I give it a good strop. So where are we at? Yeah. Very sharp. Yep, just needed a little stroppy strop. Yeah, wonderful. It responded well, that S35VN did, to some passes on a strop. All right, price and availability. Well, I already know. So, availability, it's a unicorn. All you can do is, you know, this is what I do for any knife that I become aware of that's rare. You don't see it out in the wild often. Rare sightings. You're not even sure if they exist anymore. Well, this is one of those. So what I would do, if you're interested, this one is available, by the way. I see this one pop up fairly regularly, and I think it's being retailed by somebody, like Atlantic Knives or... KnifeWorks, somebody has this version of the Dukes. So you can pick one of these up. And I'll be honest, I like it so much, I couldn't advise you quick enough to, if this size, if this is attractive to you at all, man, go get you one. Because it is really a nice little, you know, small to medium little pocket knife. I dig this one. And it's a budget knife. Shouldn't cost more than, say, $40-ish on this one. And that's with VG10 steel. Pretty cool. This one, what I would do is, if you're interested in it, I would put a search on the eBay for Kaiser Dukes Titanium. That's the search. And then I would run it. And then I would save the search, and I would let it email me if it found one. And I would check that search periodically, just because sometimes I check searches. I didn't get an email, but sure enough, there's one for sale. So the other way is to go to the Kaiser site and then just do a ISO for this particular model. Yeah, pretty cool unicorn. What would you expect to pay for it? I mean, I'm going to say 150 plus is probably where you're going to find yourself. If I sell this one, I'm probably going to be in the 175 range, maybe more, only because they are super rare. And it's an awesome knife. I dig it. Yep. I'm not looking to sell this one anytime soon, though. This one's going to go in my Kaiser collection. But if I was, I might just offer them both together for like $200, that kind of thing. Yeah, I don't know. Just talking now. Hey, society, it's in the toilet, man. I was talking to one of the friends of the channel who happens to be a knife customizer and such, and he had mentioned some making sure he had plenty of ammo, and, you know, I'm not much of a prepper, but, I mean, I'm prepared for whatever. The world has lost its mind, but not us. We're discerning in nature. Appreciate y'all watching.